Good morning, everybody. Thanks for coming. Really appreciate it. You never know who or how many people are going to come. Looks like the table got set up for us for a larger group, and who knows. We do have a couple of people who have to leave early, so I'd like to start with introductions and ask you to give us your name and generally where you live in the district, and then something about what interests and concerns you might have that you'd like us to address today.
Be a professional.
I would start with you, because I know you're one of them that has to leave early.
Yes, my name is JoAnn Kaiser. I live in Maplewood, and yet regrettably, I do have to leave early. There's a workshop on Facebook at the library that I need to come to.
I should go to that.
I'm looking forward to it, and I am very sorry that I won't be able to hear the whole presentation. I was looking forward to it.
What time does your class start?
11 o'clock.
We're going to be done about then, so, yeah. But that's good. Daniel.
Good morning. My name is Daniel Viam. I'm a retired 3M engineer. I've lived here in Woodbury since '78. I just wanted to meet my representative, because I've been on she has done such a good job of keeping me up to date with what's going on with my emails, wherever I am in the world. So
yes.
I finally had a chance when I saw the email to spend a little bit of time here. But I also may have to leave a little bit early.
Thank you. Welcome.
My name's Dennis Fent. I live in Oakdale. I know this is about healthcare, and mostly here to listen because I just want to learn more about it. I've been a teacher for a little over 40 years, and I'm very proud of that. Have a wife who was a teacher for 36 years and is now retired. So, I guess my big issues are education and healthcare. I know this one is healthcare particularly. So again, I'm mostly here to just listen and learn.
Thanks, Danny.
Morning, I'm Tony Tedesco, and I live about a mile south. My main interests are, I would say, criminal justice. I'm a prosecutor. I prosecute domestic violence. So those are kind of my main interests. I also have a soft spot in my heart for restorative justice. Been involved with the Washington County Group. I'm here, like Dennis, basically to learn about healthcare, maybe a little bit about the Affordable Care Act and how Minnesota is essentially trying to fit in with that.
Are you fixing?
Yes.
Oh, I know fake federal.
Yeah, and I'm his son, everybody else.
Yeah, of course. That's you are. Correct. Of course you are.
And I'm Florence's son.
And how is Vic?
You know, he's 92, and I took him out to dinner the other day, and he can run circles around me.
Yeah. I worked with him at Lifetime Fitness, a lot, and he's quite a character.
Okay. Is he still there?
He hasn't been there, I haven't been there either. last I heard, when he had moved over to Stone Mill Farm.
He was at Stonecrest, and then he moved back to St. Paul.
Okay.
He still pays dues at Lifetime,
okay.
And he's supposed to go, and he does want to go.
Well, he liked the aqua aerobics class, and he's singing along.
Oh, God.
No, we all loved him.
Yeah.
He's quite a character, and adds a lot of joy to the groups.
Yeah.
So I'm glad that he's doing well.
Yeah. I'll let you know.
Please, and thank you for coming.
Sure.
Joe.
Oh, my name is Joe Salmon. I live in Evergreen with JoAnn. Not
thank you.
And her husband. I'm just a political junkie. I go to all political meetings.
Mm-hmm. I'm Paul Highland, living in Woodbury, and just came to hear the discussion.
And good morning. I'm Joe Atkins. For purposes here today, I'm a state representative from Invergrove Heights. I was the chief author of MNSure legislation, primarily came here to answer questions and concerns that people have, or present whatever information you'd like to hear about it. And who are you?
I'm JoAnn Ward, and I'm your state representative, and very pleased and grateful for the opportunity to be in this position. In the past, we've just had conversations, and that's what I'd like to do again today. Joe and I talked a week or so ago about this, and I think he likes to do things the same way, and just have a conversation. There are some issues that have been bounced around in the media, making it interesting, I think, for people, and confusing to people. And so my hope is that we can clarify some of those things and just have a good conversation like we usually do. Right? So maybe some of you have a question to start with.
Well, I think we've got one.
Oh, I'm sorry, Dallas. I'm sorry. We just went right by you. Thank you.
That's okay. I'm also a political junkie. My mother's another Florence. And I also do a lot of media work, putting town halls on the web.
And Dallas Pearson.
Yes.
And thank you for coming. And I will do what I usually do, and that is just to announce that I signed up for the job, and so I'm used to the video approach, and so is Joe. But if anyone is uncomfortable with that or not, then you have the opportunity to not participate. This is the way the politics go. So thank you for being here. Questions to start with? Burning issues?
In particular, I think we got two folks that are leaving a little bit early, so if you guys have any burning questions or comments that you want to share, I just wanted to make sure.
Just wanted to meet my representative face-to-face.
Yeah.
I missed you at the door. I'm still not done door knocking yet, as long as it's not letting anybody out.
I never did.
Oh, that's the problem. Two-thirds of the people are never home. How about you? Do you have some questions about healthcare?
No, I just came to listen.
Okay.
Oh,
yes.
I was just curious from a technical point of view. I hear all this noise, and I know it's exaggerated by the other party, of course, how bad it works and the signing up, but then there was a discussion on public TV that the states that went very well. They did mention Minnesota, but I haven't heard anything about Minnesota. How is that one going?
That's a good question.
And we should distinguish, by the way, we've got when the Affordable Care Act indicated that these changes were going to have to take place, they gave two options. Congress gave us two options. And I should probably point out, by the way, I had one of the moms at my daughter's soccer match came up to me the other day, and she puts her hand on my arm and she goes, "I just wanted to let you know what a great dad you are. I mean, coming back from Washington, D.C. twice a week for Katie's soccer game is just tough." So if there was anybody that didn't know, JoAnn and I, we go to St. Paul, all the way to the state capitol.
Yeah, 9 miles from here.
We did not shut down the government for the last 3 weeks. The feds, when they passed the Affordable Care Act, they gave states two options, of course. One was to have a federal exchange imposed upon the states, and the other one was you could do it yourself. There were no other options, I was frankly quite afraid that we were going to take the default option and let the feds do it to us. And that's, for example, that's what Wisconsin has done. Minnesota has spent so much time for decades, long before JoAnn and I were even in the legislature, putting together this phenomenal healthcare system. I mean, it's got some warts and pimples like anything does, but it's a really top-flight healthcare system here in Minnesota. And to say that we were going to let the feds take that over and run their own exchange and force Minnesotans to participate in that, that to me and I think to Representative Ward and others, we didn't want to go down that path. So we opted to do our own. It's called MNSure. We basically operate as the store. We're not actually selling health insurance. And I get kind of a kick out of some folks that think we're in the business now of selling health insurance. We don't want to sell health insurance. We don't sell health insurance. But it is a market that puts customers in a position where they can shop in a competitive way on an apples-to-apples basis and have those private health insurers compete for their business. Much more than we have ever seen, literally in the history of Minnesota, we've never had this level of competition. Whether you like the Affordable Care Act or not, whether you like health exchanges or not, nobody can argue, and even the health insurers themselves, the providers or the health insurance companies, will tell you this is by far the most robust competition that they've ever engaged in. And this is America. And I say that because we like competition in this country. It's kind of what most people think made us strong. So to have those health insurers competing against one another to get Minnesotans business, and by the way, it seems to be working really well. To get now to your specific question, our rates are 88% lower than Wisconsin. And if you look at all the states, the 30 some odd states that opted for the federal exchange, their rates are almost double what we're seeing here in Minnesota. It's just, I mean, I expected the rates to be higher because when the feds do things, they tend to do it in a little more bureaucratic way. You know, the closer government is, that's why, you know, I was a mayor for 10 years. I think the best government is the most local government. You run into folks at the gas station and the grocery store and around town. And the way JoAnn and I try to do the state representative stuff, it's the same way, town meetings. And, when you can call a 651 number if you have a complaint, I think that's a lot better than dialing up a 202 number in Washington, D.C. If you have a problem. And it also impacted the rates. It's the sort of competitiveness that when they had to file their rates here in Minnesota with our own Department of Commerce rather than with the U.S. Department, that drove down rates as well. So it's, I believe, what was it, the average monthly premium across all categories was about $190 a month. And that is roughly half the cost, roughly half the average cost in states that had a federal exchange imposed upon them.
May I ask, is that due entirely to the state-based exchange, or is there, I mean, is Minnesota's cost of care just pretty much less?
I think it's a multivariable, it's been about 20 years since I took multivariable calculus back in college, but I think there's more to it. But if you look at Wisconsin and Minnesota, our healthcare systems are relatively comparable. You know, there's obviously differences, but the costs are relatively comparable. Of course, there's also individual differences, but the chief difference between the two situations at this point is that they had a federal exchange imposed upon them, and we opted to follow our own course. At last check, their rates were 88% higher in Wisconsin on the federal exchange that they had, that they opted for, versus what we did here in Minnesota. So it's, you know, and it's not just, by the way, it's not just about rates. I mean, I know that's what folks want to focus on. What I think is one of the coolest features is that there will be an opportunity to go through and take a look at a number of factors that demonstrate value in whether or not you're getting a good product for your purchase. And those sorts of things that, you know, and sometimes you're willing to pay a little bit more for a better product. You know, if we go out to dinner, if you're going to a nicer restaurant, you're used to paying a little bit more for a better piece. But that's a choice that you make. And that's all I wanted to, when we set up the exchange, set up MNSure. If folks want to opt for a little bit more expensive product, they can, if it comes with more features. But it's something that really puts the consumer in charge, rather than the health insurer. One thing I'd point out, by the way, and I get kind of a kick out of it, is that everybody, and this will, for the Democrats in the room, you're probably not going to like this comment, because I give the Republicans a lot of credit for exchanges. The Heritage Foundation actually came up with this idea about 20 years ago, and at least conceptually, and then Mitt Romney put it into place in Massachusetts. And the impact in Massachusetts, by the way, the Blue Cross Blue Shield is really hammered in Massachusetts. They lost 20% of their market share when RomneyCare went up, when their exchange went live. Because I think primarily because Blue Cross Blue Shield had the most engagement from a marketing standpoint. They have a good product. I'm not going to bash the Blues. What folks found was that on an apples-to-apples basis, they could get as good or better of a product than what they currently had in Massachusetts for a lesser price.
With Blue Cross.
With someone other than Blue Cross. So they went from about 60% market share in Massachusetts down to about 40%. And I think that's what they were afraid of happening here in Minnesota. So they have filed some of the most competitive rates, as did others. The Medicas, the Health Partners, and UCares that we've had. We've got folks that have never participated, health insurers that have never participated this heavily in the Minnesota market as they are now, because they can do it in an online fashion.
Blue Cross Blue Shield is not the same across the country anyway. Kansas, I'm more familiar with because my parents are there, my in-laws were there. When I moved my in-laws here, they changed their Blue Cross Blue Shield from Kansas to the supplemental care from Kansas to Minnesota. It saved them a ton of money, and they got better coverage with staying with Blue Cross Blue Shield, but just the difference in the state's opportunities. I don't think we still have answered one of your questions about why the press didn't mention Minnesota. Last I heard...
No, it's just an observation.
Yeah, no, it's true. What I heard was that we were fifth in the ranking that they were using. Good morning. And Kentucky, surprisingly, was first. And the reason they described that as being first is because they had a very simple plan and a very simple process, very simple website, and the technology was very simple. So you probably know more about that than I do, but that was what they said.
And I, you know, quite honestly, I don't read a lot of newspaper articles about it. I've read so many articles, you could spend all day, and I have, I've actually got a real job. Unlike a lot of, most legislators, I think, are part-time legislators, and that's one of the cool things about Minnesota. So I read a few articles here and there. I don't know that I specifically read the one that you referenced, but...
No, this was on public radio.
Yeah, public radio did one.
Okay. But I'm writing from Minnesota.
I heard fifth. Mm-hmm. And Seattle? What were the
others? Fifth for what, though?
In ease of access and how they had started. I'm sorry, that's a good question. How the rollout had worked. And it was primarily because Kentucky's was so simple.
I heard on TV that California was claim, Krugman mentioned it. California went very well.
I don't remember what the other four or three were. I remember Washington State was really good. But it kind of depends on, you know, your point is well taken. What's the criteria? The speed of the rollout and the number of people that get enrolled, or the cost, or the benefits. How is all that working? I know what I'm hearing from people is that they can't wait for the 1st of January.
It's an enormous project.
It is an enormous project. Most of us in this room have other options, and we have not had to wait for this one to come along.
Well, I was talking to a cancer survivor the other day who hasn't been able to afford coverage. She can't wait for January 1. It'll be interesting to see how it does roll out. I mean, I would not anticipate that we'll have a huge amount of enrollment until people actually have to do it, which isn't until January.
Or March.
They've actually got until March, and most people, if they're like me anyway, they try to avoid paying as long as they can. If you're not requiring payment until January or March, that's probably when I'm going to do it. So.
Are we getting a sense at all if, I know the concern was, will the younger, healthier people be signing up, or will this be primarily folks who couldn't get insurance because of pre-existing conditions, that kind of thing, which are going to load down the system with cost?
Yeah, I think it's anecdotal at this point.
Okay,
I mean, I've heard a number of the young people who can navigate through these things quickly have gone on taken a look at it, haven't purchased anything, again, because most of them don't need to purchase until 2014. But we've had lots and lots of, and I say we passed the legislation. The implementation is actually being taken place by the, or put in place by the MNSure staff. But what they've indicated is they've had all sorts of exploratory, you know, lots of people that have gone on, looked around. You don't have to enroll, you don't have to create an account. You can literally go on and just take a look at what the site offers, do some comparison shopping. The one thing that you don't figure out is to the extent that you qualify for a premium discount. Under the federal law, they provide a federal tax credit. And if you haven't created an account, you can't figure out exactly how much that tax credit would be for you, because it's income dependent and all of that. But everything else, all of the other functionality, you can do without even creating an account or logging in.
We should stop and go back and pick up. We have some additional people come in, so I'd like you to introduce yourselves and tell us if there's something particularly about healthcare that you'd like to have us talk about.
I'm Richard Newmark from Woodbury. And one thing that I'm not sure very many people realize yet is that companies like 3M are no longer giving health care to retirees before they reach Medicare age. And so anybody who's retiring between 60 and 62 is going to be faced with the issue that they have pre-existing conditions. There's no way they can get health coverage without something like the Affordable Care Act. I think there's a failure for an awful lot of Republicans to appreciate how critical that portion of the act is.
Thank you. Glad to see you.
Alberta Gillespie, and I'm here to listen and learn.
And you live in Woodbury, too?
Oh, I do. I live in Woodbury. Yeah. Proudly.
Yeah. Thanks. Glad you're here.
John Becker from Oakdale. I liked Alberta's response. That's what I'm here to listen and learn.
Well, primarily, for folks who are a little bit late, we talked primarily thus far about MNSure, a little less so about the Affordable Care Act, although the two are somewhat intertwined with one another. To me, the point that you made is absolutely the most important. You can no longer, and the gal that talked to had cancer a few years ago, made the same exact point. If you've had any kind of pre-existing condition, and now that I got a little bit more gray hair than I used to have, I've got so many pre-existing conditions, it's scary. So between that and then allowing kids to stay on their parents' insurance for a while longer, guaranteed issue so that you can't get turned down as part of the pre-existing condition element, those are kind of the key parts. The Affordable Care Act, frankly, still kind of scares me a little bit. As it's implemented, the details of it are always a little scary, but to the extent that we can do as much here in Minnesota and control as much, that's what I alluded to when before you guys got here. It's part of the reason we opted to move forward with on the exchange, the MNSure exchange here in Minnesota ourselves, is because the less control that the feds have over or influence over our health care, the more we like it. And I know Wisconsin and some other states opted to do the federal exchange, but the proof is in the numbers there. We've got the lowest rates in the country here in Minnesota. They're 88% lower than what we're seeing in Wisconsin. On an average, that's apples to apples comparison, monthly average premium. So I think it's demonstrating that we follow the right course. Whether you like the Affordable Care Act, whether you like exchanges or not, the one decision that was very easy to make was it absolutely made sense to do our own rather than let Washington, D.C. do it for us.
I think it's also helpful to me to remember that the Affordable Care Act was something that was built on compromise. As a lot of legislation is, I don't think any of it, I don't think the end product was what any one person wanted. There was some give and take in there. And so I think that's going to contribute to some of the how do we work this out? How is it going to be implemented? And I do hear from constituents who are in exactly that situation and hoping to be in a good position still physically by the time they can actually get the coverage. And one of the other confusions that I have heard in previous town hall meetings and even a year ago, because your kids are 25, doesn't mean you have to have them. It's an option to keep them on until they're 26. And people say, I don't want my kids on my healthcare, you know, I want them to get out and do their own thing. Well, you know, that's fine if they can. But if they can't, if they're not in a position to, then they can stay under parents' coverage. There's so many misconceptions about things.
Well, actually, and JoAnn, that's a great point. I had a colleague of mine in my law practice. He's got his son who's in about that. I think he's 23 or 24. And it was in the neighborhood of $400 and some odd a month on our policy. Mm-hmm. Versus he went and looked at the MNSure website, and it was like 178. I don't remember the exact number. But it's worth taking a look at. Mm-hmm. Just because you can keep your kids on your policy doesn't necessarily mean it's the, and it was for apples to apples coverage, comparable coverage. In fact, I think the coverage on that he was looking at through MNSure was probably a little bit better than what we offer at the law firm. I hate to admit that, but for a much more affordable price.
Well, that was one of the conversations that I had at the door even last summer as we were talking about getting to this point with the legislature even before the election. And people were saying, oh, my company's just not going to be able to afford health care. It's getting more and more expensive. And they were concerned that if the state and the federal level went ahead with any kind of coverage, that it would mean that their company would give it up. They just would not offer it anymore. And I felt like I could honestly say, your company's not going to be able to do it anyway. It's becoming too expensive for companies to offer those benefits. They're looking for alternatives. So I think the employer-provided health care is probably a dinosaur. Maybe not for a long time, but most, I think there are going to be some big changes coming in that area. And not because there is an alternative, but I think we have to have the alternative because it's too prohibitively expensive for businesses.
I was wondering if costs of employee health care, I'm employed, thank goodness, and get my insurance through my employer, might face some downward pressure if there's a wider spectrum of insured people now. Mm-hmm. I didn't know if perhaps with the exchanges, perhaps especially in Minnesota, there might be some downward pressure on insurance as a you know, as it's offered for companies.
Well, that's certainly what we're hoping for it. My little law firm, and we've never felt like we could really get competitive bids because we're not 3M, for example, where they can go into the market and be on a level playing field with the insurers. So we're hoping that as and Minnesota, by the way, also has plans on the exchange, on the MNSure exchange for small businesses, and just having that availability hopefully will bring some pressure in the outside market as well. One thing, by the way, keep in mind, by the way, when you offer guaranteed coverage with where you can't turn people down for pre-existing conditions, that does push prices up. So I fully expect that the Affordable Care Act will have some upward pressure on pricing when insurance companies can't turn those folks away. The point of competition, especially the kind of really robust competition that we have on the exchange, is to have downward pressure so that we don't see the prices go up too much. But I guess the proof will be in the practice when we see what happens in the coming months. Yes, sir?
No, I think I should add, I don't want to say that I really believe Obamacare is the best thing that can be done. The big problem is that it does certain things extremely well, and now it's really up to the Congress to go about trying to figure out ways to reduce the total cost of Medicare, especially, and the Affordable Care Act to a lesser extent, so that this country can afford to provide health care to its citizens. Because you look at England or Canada, they provide health care to everybody. They're not letting people who come up with cancer at the age of 40 to die because they can't get any health care coverage for it. And cancer is one of the few things you can't go to an emergency room and get treated.
Well, and the 800-pound gorilla that we haven't addressed is drug prices. We basically subsidize the rest of the world. Our consumers, American consumers, pay through the nose sometimes 10 or 20 times as much here in the United States and in Europe and elsewhere around the world, their drug prices are sometimes as little as one-tenth of what they are here in the United States. And it's primarily because we haven't fostered competition. You can't, for example, when Governor Plenty talked about reimportation, you know, literally buying some of our prescription drugs, exactly the same drugs from Ireland or Germany, the federal government just came and beat him down. And he eventually relented and backed away from that. Governor Dayton, remember, when he was Senator Dayton, I think, was driving the bus or had the bus that was going to Canada. And some of that pressure has been relieved as a result of Medicare changes, Part D changes. But there's still lots of folks. I just read an article the other day, kids with asthma, and $150 or $200 a month or more just for basic asthma treatment when it's $7 in European countries.
Why is that? Is it because of patenting or?
There's multiple factors, all of which work to the benefit of the drug companies, patenting and repatenting, and then patenting the left version versus the right version of the molecular structure of the, I mean, all of those sorts of things that are allowed here in the United States that drive away competition. You know, exactly what we're trying to do with MNSure, enhance competition, we're not doing with respect to drugs. And that's why the experts will tell you it's driving 50% of our increases in healthcare costs in the United States are due to increases in prescription drug prices.
But this is a hot subject for me because I could get my, when I was working for 3M, I could get my Lipitor in Holland for a fraction of the cost. And I would suggest to 3M that I buy it there where they would reimburse me. And they said no, because it was out of network. I couldn't convince them that they would save a hell of a lot of money. But correct me if I'm wrong, but my understanding is that what we do to lobbying, that the U.S. Congress doesn't allow Medicare
to negotiate
drug prices.
Is it's just crazy. Yeah, they can't have the drug makers compete against one another. Yeah.
So they can ask
whatever
they want. But
he can lower his price, right. Yeah.
So how can we change that?
Well, I bought the stock of these companies.
That's a solution.
If you can't beat them, I guess, yeah. Right?
Is Betty McCollum aware of this? Is she
doing
anything about it? Or?
Yeah, no, every time you talk to an individual congressman or woman, they agree with you, but who are the ones then obstructing it? That's the part I don't understand. Another question out of curiosity. I've followed this whole deal because the interesting thing to me is that the Affordable Health Care Act looks very I know all these European countries have different ways of doing it, but this looks very much the same as what they have in Holland. They until 10 or 15 years ago, the government was handling this like one huge Medicare system. And then they went out of the business, and now every fall you get all these people get all these mailings with these competing, and it's published on websites which one has the best deal. And it seems to work very well. Even though from a technical point of view, I think the quality is better. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Quality. But what I don't understand in all these discussions last year, what the opposition to this law is based on, because I never hear any facts about that. Is it purely ideological? That out of principle, the government shouldn't be involved in that, or what is it?
I guess it'd be better to talk to some of the opponents. One of the.
You never hear an argument.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you, speaking for me, I've got real reservations about it because whenever the feds come in and tell us how to do things, that troubles me, whether it's education or health care or whatever it may be.
Minnesota solved it.
As long as they give Minnesota the opportunity to do it in a Minnesota way, I can live with that. If they had said that they're going to just impose a federal health exchange on us, I would not have been as keen on that. Because when you have, if you have a problem, for example, and you got to dial somebody out in the 202 area code, and they're shut down for 3 weeks at a crack because of what Congress was and the President were doing out there, that I find problematic. But so long as we can do most of the sorts of things here in Minnesota and protect what we've made such an investment in over time, that's much more appealing to me. I don't know, are there others? I mean, if there's folks that don't like the Affordable Care Act,
Or MNSure.
Or MNSure, and certainly an opportunity to weigh in and share what your concerns are.
Well, I know how in the past, when I was in law school, and I know the guy next to me had the same surgeon who was living out on the street, and he didn't pay, but I found out it came out of my insurance, which is a little bit inefficient way of doing it, of course. This seems to be, to me at least, better organized.
May I ask, I know there were concerns about the transition from Minnesota's insurance system, which, whether there were gaps in coverage. I know that a number of them were covered in the last session. Are there still people who are, you know, making too much to have the expanded Medicaid but aren't covered yet by, you know, a sufficient subsidy in order to make healthcare coverage affordable? Or has that been pretty well taken care of?
My sense is that has been addressed. And we've got a category of folks in MinCare, which is a program for it's the insurer of last resort. It's expensive. It's a situation where if you can't get insurance because of pre-existing conditions for the most part, that you can go through that. We've also got a plan in place now to transition those folks, many of whom are in a really tough situation, from there to MinSure. I give Commissioner Rothman and the Department of Commerce a ton of credit for they've spent months and months making sure that we're not leaving anybody behind. And I think that's going to be critical as we roll this out.
Going back to the question regarding what are the specific objections to the Affordable Health Care Act, because I've engaged with lots of people and I hear things like, it's going to kill our country. And these are people I call friends. So, but not any specifics about what are the real objections. So I'm interested in the answer to that question as well. Like, what are the real objections to it?
I guess you don't want to speak for the people.
So what are the?
They haven't articulated them very well. Is my issue.
Maybe what are the holes? Where are the gaps?
I assume some people have some real issues and other than talking points and screaming points, but I haven't been able to hear what those are.
I got on conservative websites just before the shutdown, and I thought, this just seems so insane to me, to shut down the government because...
for something that wasn't going to work anyway, but yeah.
Right. But they are afraid, that if and when Obamacare goes into effect, it will be the end of free market in terms of medical care. I think there's the idea that people kind of resent that their own coverage is going to be more expensive because they're going to have to cover people with pre-existing conditions. I'm not sure what the other option is. You know, it seems a bit cruel to say, well, too bad, you can't get covered. But I fear that that's, or I mean, I think that that's the fear, that the free market is no longer being allowed to operate because it's so hamstrung by all these requirements, having to take people with pre-existing conditions and no lifetime limits on coverage, that kind of thing.
Well, I'll give you, the part of the way it's being paid for example, with the medical device tax.
Right.
That's a big deal,
right.
Particularly in places like Minnesota, where we've got a number of medical device makers. Yeah, and so there's some of those specific issues. But if anything, it actually enhances the market competition. Private insurers now are scrambling for business here in Minnesota through MNSure. They want to make sure that they capture as many customers as they can. It's anticipated, I believe it was the figures we got, it's about 300,000 currently uninsured Minnesotans will get insurance, some for the very first time in their life.
300,000?
Yeah. And if you don't, by the way, if you don't think uninsured people cost you money, what happens is if you're uninsured, you don't go to the doctor.
And we pay for the emergency room.
And then you go to the emergency room where the cost is 100 times more expensive. And who pays for the emergency room? Your property taxes. So it makes it less direct, but you still pay for it and you pay a lot more than if people had basic insurance.
And there are probably a lot of young people that think they're infallible and not buying it. Well, they can't afford it.
Yeah, I heard the term yesterday, the invincible young. The invincible young don't think they need insurance, you know.
Well, it's like car insurance, liability insurance. I have a perfect 54-year record, so I may think, well, I'm not going to, nothing's going to happen to me. I can do without insurance, but I realize that there has to be a law that forces me to have car insurance, so I don't understand what they do.
But the young kids, I spend a lot of time with young adults, and they don't necessarily believe that. They just couldn't afford health care, a lot of them. And so they have to pay rent versus paying for insurance and pay for their rent because, you know, they don't have a lot of extra income. So I think they don't necessarily think they're invincible. We assume that they do, but there are a lot of them that would like to have health insurance, so more than we probably think.
Well, and they're trading off expenses and trying to be responsible with their money, it still means that if they run into trouble medically, then we pick it up.
Yeah, I actually talked, I've got two sons who are now 20 and 19, mm-hmm. and you know, they grew up in my household, so they had to have a little bit of civic awareness, and I asked them that question, and they said, in a relatively kind way, but that old people, meaning me, don't give them enough credit. I mean, their point was, yeah, we'd like health insurance. I mean, we understand, you know, we don't expect to go to the doctor a lot, although both of mine have been to the doctor in the last month from sports-related injuries. Oh. I mean, it's what they do. But they said, you know, the bottom line is it was always so expensive. You know, everybody that we talked to went out to get health insurance. And I told them the average rate for somebody in their age category is under $90 if you buy through MNSure. That was, I believe it was for a 23-year-old living in the Twin Cities. It was, and regardless of gender, the only thing you can rate on is smoking and age. But for a non-smoking 23-year-old in Twin Cities, under $90 a month, or $91. And that was before any sort of premium discount. So if they happen to qualify for one of the tax credit, that may actually bring it down. But it's a matter of affordability. And if they're talking $400 a month or something like that, they just aren't going to do it. If you're talking 50 or 60 or 90.
So health insurance can increase depending on your age?
Yes.
Okay, that I didn't know.
That is one of the factors, although the spread was shocking to me in terms of, I really expected it, you know, when I talked about the $91 rate, that was our lowest rate here in the Twin Cities for a 23-year-old. They also did a 40-year-old, and I believe they did a 63-year-old. And I expected the 63-year-old to be $700 or $800 or $900 a month or something. It was, I believe it was two something, was the average, 234, 243. So obviously more expensive than for the 23-year-old, but not 7 or 8 or 10 times, which is what I kind of thought it might be.
That was actually mandated by the ACA, although I think the ratio you're talking about is lower than the mandate. So. Mm-hmm. But it was mandated.
Yeah.
It can't be.
The spread can't be that wide. It was still, my concern though was that we were going to see rates that were so much higher, or that they would push up the low rates so that you'd have, as Dallas talked about, it would push up the rates for the 23-year-old in order to keep the spread from being too wide. You know, and bottom line is we just ended up with the lowest rates in the country. For a lot of reasons, give a lot of credit to a lot of folks who pushed hard, and to the insurers themselves, frankly. I mean, as much as some folks may not like them, they really did get down and compete. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that they want to secure as much of the market share as they can from this new group of buyers.
Just from a little, I'll share an observation of mine as a first-term legislator, being on several of the committees that heard the MNSure bill, and did it actually go through more committees than any other bill in the history of the state?
We think since statehood, it got more hearings than any other bill.
And it got vetted very thoroughly. It going through so many committees and sitting through those hearings and the hours and hours and hours of questions that this man actually had respond to, and it got vetted, and it passed handily.
Well, and we should, I mean, it's, in fairness, we should give credit. I'm a Democrat, Joanne's Democrat, but the probably half the language in the final legislation was written by Republicans. I give them a great deal of credit for, as we went through the committee process, for strengthening the security of the data. Privacy was a key concern. Affordability was a key concern.
Competition.
And they did, they really did. Some of their amendments I thought were silly. In fairness, I thought were ridiculous. But a whole bunch of them made a lot of sense. And about half that law was written by Republicans. So I, you know, give credit where it's due. I appreciated their efforts as well.
There were serious concerns about accessibility and the privacy issues, and those got addressed thoroughly. Dallas, you had a question?
Yeah, the Heritage Plan you talked about earlier was really what came about in the e-insurance products that were on available. So they were exchanges that have existed for the last 10 years. I think they're going out of business as a result next year, because their plans aren't, none of their plans will be acceptable to ACA. What was the comparison between e-insurance, e-health insurance, and this new exchange plan, MNSure? Did you investigate that, or?
Dallas, do you mean in terms of prices, or do you mean in terms of products,
prices,
or
coverage,
operation?
Deductibles?
First, from an operational standpoint, they weren't attracting as many of the private insurers. We've got private insurers now that are participating in an online marketplace through MNSure that haven't done so before. And one of them, for example, is UCARE, that has really been a driver of the big boys. UCARE is a more modest-sized, very, very credible, very appropriately funded, but just couldn't compete, you know, on the, you know, running ads all the time and doing that kind of thing. And they've been a real driver in terms of bringing enhanced competition and, as a result, more competitive prices. I wouldn't say that you could really do a good comparison between the earlier iterations of e-surance or e-insurance.
E-health insurance.
Yeah, and there were a number of different entities, private entities, that have tried to establish a marketplace without a great deal of success over time. They just couldn't get all of the players to participate. As a result of MNSure, we've got more private insurers participating. I was hoping for four. I think we have seven of the insurers in Minnesota. And in particular, I wanted to get some of the smaller folks. Those smaller folks, the hungrier private insurers, are the ones that are really driving the competition. They're the ones, you know, it's like any business. Just because it's online or it's health insurance and sounds complicated, it's like anything. If you've got a competitor down the street, you know, hungry new competitor, entrepreneurial, and they're offering great service at lower prices, it takes the big boys and brings their prices down and their service up. And we got some of those smaller, the UCARES, for example, that are participating heavily in MNSure, and they are really pushing the big guys. And that's only good for consumers anyway. It may not be good for the big folks, but it's great for consumers.
I'm wondering if there is some way Minnesota, even ahead of the rest of the nation, can get into looking at costs. I keep hearing that no matter what goes on in the Affordable Health Care Act, we still have cost issues to deal with. I'm thinking about things like end-of-life care, which kind of, you know, dissipated in that whole death panels debate, and you know, which I thought was a little unfortunate. Prevention initiatives. And the cost model, which is fee-for-service. I know that Mayo and some other places are beginning to look at, you know, kind of an outcome-based sort of thing. Are there initiatives like that that are possible in this state?
Beck, you know, I was just talking with Ken Paulus, who is the CEO of Alina Hospitals and Healthcare System. And he said within 5 years, he expects that we will see significant changes in those cost drivers. And one of the things that he talked about and that he thinks is coming relatively soon is, he called it the management or population of a whole, where you would take an entire group of folks. Maybe it's 50,000 people or 100,000 bodies. And a system like Alina would bid to be responsible for the healthcare of that group, with the main aim being to keep them well, rather than treat them after they got sick. And all of the experts, I'm sure you all know this already, but it's a lot cheaper to keep somebody well than it is to treat them once they got sick, especially if they have emergent situation, they have a heart attack, for example. And there was one of the things that that Ken Paul has talked about, is there's all sorts of signs of when somebody's going to have a heart attack. Mm-hmm. If you can get ahead of that, you know, get them eating right, on the treadmill, doing that sort of thing, you can save yourself a huge amount of money. But right now our system is set up to treat the sick, not to keep people well. And so that is those sorts of hopes that, and that's, you know, we've been talking primarily, so I'm glad you brought this up, because we've been talking a lot about health insurance, but not about health care reform. And I think that's, we're going to start seeing some of those discussions. And especially the fact that we can have those discussions at the state level. The feds are so gall darn dysfunctional. I mean, they are in hopeless gridlock. And I don't really expect to see anything come out of that place for a long time. But I do think the door is open for Minnesota to do things. And the fact that folks like Ken Paulus and others are looking at that, I think, is a good sign.
Well, you know, if you talking about cost, if you look at, let's say, for example, you went to the doctors 10 years ago, and then you go today, the two appointments will be polar. 10 years ago, the doctor talked to you. Today, he talks to his computer. And the thing is, if you, a friend of mine who was thinner than I am, showed me his report from a diabetes doctor of what happened that day. And one of the discussions they had was about obesity. Well, you know, no they didn't. However, the doctor has to put that down because his patient is a diabetic, therefore they had to talk about obesity. And I think those are some of the things you're talking about. The cost has risen because they're obligated to do certain things that are not necessarily necessary. And therefore, the cost of a doctor's visit has skyrocketed over the years because he's got to fulfill it. You know, when he sends that report, then the doctor does, to the Department of Health, and they scan it and they say, well, you know, among other things, I'm just using this as an example because I remember it, you didn't talk to this guy about obesity, and he's a diabetic. You're not doing your job. Well, no, the guy's probably underweight, if anything. He's certainly not obese. But yet that's all part of the program that they have to follow to satisfy the Department of Health. And I think those are the things that I think you started talking about, you know, have we investigated the cost? Part of the cost is what's obligated by the Department of Health for the doctor to do. And if we could ever straighten that out, much more so than the cost of insurance, is the cost of a doctor's visit. As an example, my wife had a, she broke up a dog fight and she got bit on this finger, and she went to the emergency room and they said, well, this looks really bad. You'll probably have to have that lanced. Well, needless to say, one day, one night hospital stay and a little surgery on her finger, Medicare's portion of the bill, we haven't seen the bill yet, Medicare's portion of the bill that they paid was $5,300. Mm-hmm. Well, 10 years ago, that would have probably been $500. You know, and I think that's one of the things that we really need to look at, is why do we pay so much for everything that happens in the medical field when it might not necessarily be necessary?
And the only, you know, the infuriating thing to me is that my doctor is a friend of mine, besides being my physician for the last 30 years. And when I go to see him, I have no idea how much that appointment's going to cost, mm-hmm. and neither does he. Mm-hmm. And it's just the most, you know, any other service in the world, right? I mean, even a lawyer. You ask the lawyer how much the charge is, and you'll get an answer. You go to a doctor's office, nobody seems to know. Mm-hmm. But he was telling me, and the only piece, Joe, that I take issue with is that he says that the average amount that he gets paid per office visit has actually gone down over the last decade.
Well, that's his share of Medicare.
No, it's not, he's not talking about Medicare. He's talking about dealing with the private insurers. Mm-hmm. And Medicare, you got to give Medicare some credit because they, I represent sometimes some injured folks in my law practice, and I see the amount. Medicare is such a tough negotiator with providers. I mean, there was one yesterday, and I won't ever talk about a client's name, but she had $8,000 in medical bills. Medicare had paid $1,532.
Right.
And boy, they tell you what you're going to get paid when it comes to the provider. Where I think the cost drivers are really coming from is some of the specialty care, number one, and then what we talked about earlier with some of the prescription drugs, where you're seeing, you know, thousands, tens of thousands of dollars being spent on certain specialty drugs or specialty care. My guess is that a big chunk of your wife's situation, you know, an emergency room visit's expensive. It's the most expensive. We talked earlier, Elver, but it's 100 times sometimes as expensive as doing maintenance care. But then that the procedure itself tends to be a big cost driver, where the specialist comes in. And I'm, mm-hmm. if there's specialists watching our show, I'm not trying to put them out of business, but it is a significant cost driver if you talk to some of the health insurance providers.
Yeah, as long as you bring up specialists, I'll bring up another single case issue for you. One of the things I've heard about on ACA is that they're going to limit your ability to see specialists, probably going like to the HMO model where you have an assigned doctor, not the one you had in the past, and you're limited as to what you can see for a specialist. In my case, I had to go through two specialists. The first one took a year and a half of many tests. He finally sent me to an endocrinologist who said, oh, there's only one thing that causes that, and had surgery about a month ago, and issue solved. What's the limitations in MNSure for that kind of visit? Are specialists limited in any fashion like ACA probably is?
No, actually MNSure doesn't put any limitations on it. All it is serving as a marketplace for the private insurers to sell their product.
So it sets the rules for what has to be covered and how.
There's under the policy. Affordable Care Act, there's certain floors of coverage that need to be offered. As far as the specific question you raised, though, about being referred to a specialist, I think that's already, I can't imagine that the Affordable Care Act is going to make that any more difficult than what you've already been through, Dallas. We've had the same in my own family and then people that I know. It's difficult to get to a specialist now. And I think the main reason for that is that the health insurers are figuring that out, too. They make it really hard because they know it's going to be expensive. So they want to make certain that you've, you know, dotted every I and crossed every T before that referring doctor can send you out. In fact, my own physician was telling me he has to be really careful now about making that referral, because if he makes a wrong referral, somehow the insurer comes back after him, and there could be an economic consequence to it. I mean, that's how challenging it has become for physicians to work with insurers. And, you know, I guess I can understand the insurer's side, which is, you know, we want to keep the price as modest as we can because it gets it ultimately reflected in the premium. But I can also understand Tony's frustration. Tony's my doctor, where, you know, if he wants to make a referral, is doing it in good faith and he knows the person needs, it's just a, I don't know, it's a very difficult situation.
Well, I think there's going to be a piggyback on your comment about your conversation with the Alina CEO. Some of the medical device companies are recognizing, we've got a very complicated situation going back to making things happen and the doctors protecting themselves. If I'm a little concerned that mom might fall, the doctor's going to be really sure that they have a walker or whatever level of support they need. My parents are elderly. They don't need anywhere near the services that a lot of other elderly people do. They're independent, they don't need hearing aids, glasses use is pretty minimal, they don't have walkers, they don't have oxygen, any of these kinds of things, but the presumption is that they do. So you must need an extra light, and they really don't, you know, but there is a, if they don't provide the walker or the medical device of whatever kind, then they're subject to, you know, not providing adequate service. So there, it's an art, and we're treating it much more like a science than it is. I think we have a lot more conversations to have, but I think we're going to be moving more towards the health, health care in providing resources and incentives and lifestyle choices so that people have the opportunity and the support from their doctors. Our doctor's appointments have changed a lot more to support healthy lifestyles and healthy choices instead of exploring what's wrong with you. You know, what can I find that's wrong with you that I have to fix now?
We're hearing from the long-term care community, to your question earlier about the things that are driving cost. There's also sort of the transition into talking about long-term care issues. Where do you want to, you know, as you age, where do you want to be when you get older? I want to be in my house as long as I can. The emergence of some of the e-technologies that, you know, that allow you to communicate with your doctor from home. They can monitor your situation, and you stay in your home longer. The cost savings from staying in your own home, not just to your personal savings, but in terms of public costs. And I'm hoping that that becomes part of the conversation over the next few years as well, is how can we let people just stay in their homes longer and still be monitored by their doctors and know that they're doing okay. See, folks, I've actually got people coming to, I told them I'd be late. They're coming to my house to watch the Gophers game at 11. I forewarned my wife, there's going to be a bunch of guys in our basement by the time I get home. But I really did want to tell you how much I appreciate this. This has been great. You don't know quite what this question.
You don't know what it costs to go to the doctor. And, you know,
I don't think anybody does.
No one does.
Why not?
Except the ones that pay cash. Now, that we do have a whole new growth of doctors who will not accept Medicare, will not accept any insurance, and they will accept only cash. And the interesting thing about that is they do publish in the office, an office visit costs $40, this, you know, a shot for the flu or something costs $5. It's all there. Whatever they do is public. Now, one of the main concerns is with the Affordable Care Act that they will not be allowed to do that. Now, in the socialized medicine countries in Europe, especially Eastern Europe, they have the doctors who teach and then work in a socialized hospital also then go to their own practice, which is outside of the government programs. And, you know, the question always comes up, will they be allowed to do that here? And the answer most often received is no, they can't, because they'll be outside of the system. Have any thoughts about that?
Yeah. Can you explain something to me? I hear this all the time in the U.S. I've heard it for 40 years. I don't have a clue, even though I grew up for 33 years in Europe, what this means. Everybody's asking, what is socialized medicine, or what is a socialized hospital? I've never seen one. What does it mean?
What's run by the government?
Single payer system.
Oh, it's been interesting.
Yeah, but it's Medicare. It's communism or something.
It's socialism. Yeah, Medicare. Yeah.
I don't think so.
Yeah.
I think definition is a little bit different, but.
In terms of paying for a doctor, by the way, my doctor is $154 a visit. 10 years ago, it was $35. Interestingly enough, he gets, I think, $80 from the insurance company and $35 from me now.
And that's
even less than that.
Thanks for sharing that, though, Dale. I, and as I would like to continue to see doctors. If they want to practice in the fashion you described, I'd like to see them be able to continue to do that.
Yeah. Because you are correct, they are getting squeezed tremendously. So many doctors say that they just don't know why they're going to go on.
Yeah, especially the older doctors that have been practicing for a while. They're so frustrated.
Mm-hmm.
And the young ones, they don't know any better, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
But they feel that as well. Speaking of the young ones and the new ones, I did want to leave you with one comment about my friend Representative Ward. Thank you for sending her to the Capitol. She has been, I mean, she's thoughtful and independent-minded and conscientious and everything that you would want to have in a legislator. I just wish all 134 of us were the same way, where we don't get so buckled down and entrenched in one political persuasion or another. It was really a breath of fresh air to have you in the Capitol.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I know you want to go, but
it's okay.
In terms of keeping your own doctor, my spouse has already launched 2 specialty clinics as a result of Obamacare. And they've been open about the reason why. I can't give you a whole paragraph or description on why. Bottom line is, she's lost those 2 specialty clinics as a result of Obamacare. Nothing, she didn't have anything, any choice in the matter. One specialty clinic, she was dealing with them for about 18 years. The other one, about 10 or 12. So we're feeling an impact. It's personal.
And
you're going to be, I can't imagine.
No, I'm not.
It's all anecdotal.
I
don't want to kind of breach any confidences or security, issues or privacy issues, But those are direct impacts. So it's not a matter of, can I pay cash? She no longer has those physicians.
Yeah. Actually, if we could, and I'm not going to argue, with you that what you say is, but I would be interested to find out more about it, maybe in a one-on-one, because it would be.
Right. I would basically, have those practices come back, but I don't want to get in the middle of that. I mean, we got letters said, the initial one said, as a result of, and then the next one followed up, they saw from the language and basically didn't say as a result of specifically the Affordable Care Act or Obamacare, but as a result of legislation, national legislation or something like that. It was a euphemism for basically that. The other clinic was, she's had a relationship with this physician, so they were pretty open, as a result of
I'd be kind of interested to talk with the clinics themselves, if you can just let us know offline. I know it makes people a little, when you got, no offense to Alice, but when you're talking about health issues, especially personal ones, but I'd be interested in talking directly to the clinics to find out what they're.
I'll see if they're,
Okay.
I think that goes kind of back to what you were saying, without specifics and what we don't know, because I'm not assuming that affordable health care is perfect, and I think we all know it's not, given the rollout of it. But without specifics, then you can't fix it, you can't make it better. And so how do we get to the point of saying, give me specifics about what's not working or what the fears or concerns are, so then we can work to make it better? Because I don't think anyone would say we think it's 100% of what we would want it to be. I wouldn't say that.
I appreciate that, because we can't do anything about it unless we do know some of those stories.
And I have some concerns about, I'll tell you later because we have to go.
But there are some that are, and I'm not insinuating that her particular clinics are doing this, but there are some that are using it as kind of an excuse for doing some other things.
But we will need to follow up on it.
And that's why I want to know.
This,
we should talk with them.
Right. No, this has been going on. I'm sorry, it's like, well, I never heard this before. This has been going on.
Mm-hmm.
Dredging. The Affordable Care Act started in 2010.
Army Corps of Engineers.
Minnesota was having hearings. You mentioned all the hearings. How long have we been having those? This isn't a new issue about will you be able to keep your doctor? Will practices be going out of business? This isn't a new issue. So the fact that you weren't aware of it is like,
no,
really? Somebody wasn't listening?
No, I have heard that. But I it's anecdotal, and I need to be able to have some specifics to follow up on it.
Now that's all we're talking about.
And what I hear is more along the line of what John was talking about, is the kind of the fear thing that, you know, I'm going to lose my clinic, or there's going to be some threats of things. I have not heard anything substantive, and I would be happy to follow up on it.
But thank you for raising that. Yeah. And if others encounter, by the way, if others encounter the same sorts of things, and the more specifics that you can provide, the easier it is for us to follow up on it. Because that's not, what you just described is legally not supposed to occur under the terms of the Affordable Care Act. So what you described is something that it'd be good to follow up on specifically and find out what exactly they're alleging in their letters as far as legislation that would have caused them to do that. And what I've heard about, what I talked about earlier about, is some are using it as an excuse to take actions that they wanted to do, but now they've got kind of a boogeyman that they can blame it on. So it'd be interesting to follow up on that one, is all I'm saying. You guys, again, thank you very much for taking the time for me this morning. It was
thank
a pleasure
you,
to be with you. I'll wash your hands, by the way. I just coughed into this.
Okay. thank you.
And have a great weekend, guys.
Thank you, Joe. Fun with the game.
Yeah.
I hope it goes well.
Oh.
And the sun looks like it's coming out. I'm supposed to be at, I was at there earlier this morning at Fish Creek in Maplewood. They're doing a buckthorn busting event, and I need to go back and cheer the troops on since I'm not there pulling out the buckthorn. But I'd be happy to stay a few more minutes if anybody has other questions.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Well, I'm sorry, I got a little